The first couple of years, you just have anxiety attacks on stage. I hated it so much.
Starting your career with a cover has proved to be a blessing and a curse for Nick Murphy. The artist, once known as Chet Faker, released his rendition of No Diggity in 2011. It went viral, and since then, it's seen him become one of the world's most unique artists. 8 years on, and a few records later, he's dropped his stage name, switched up his musical style, and he just finished recording with Rick Rubin. So I thought I'd catch up with him. Nick, thanks for joining me today.
Thanks for having me. You too, man. It's been a minute.
Last time you had like a whole different name.
Hey, it was definitely a different spelling, yeah.
Yeah.
I just kind of was like, I have to set this shit on fire to make sure I'm still doing this for the music, you know?
Well, because initially you chose the moniker Chet Faker because someone else had your name.
Exactly, yeah.
And was performing, right?
Yeah. I mean, I had a few other little names and it was always meant to be temporary, that project. Actually, part of what the Chet Faker project was supposed to be was to never be played live, which obviously you failed at that.
Has the other Nick Murphy reached out to you and said, like, what's the deal, dude?
Oh, no, I mean, I don't know. Maybe.
Have you out-successed him?
I doubt it. He was there first, you know what I mean? If it's a race, he won. My sanity comes to quest.
What I need is someone to burn up on my gut. Were you prepared for sort of a collective eye roll or any kind of disillusionment?
Totally. Yeah, totally. I mean,
does that make you feel scared about?
No.
Being less successful or?
No, I mean, man, I seriously don't do this for success. It's great, and I like, in a capitalist sense, sure, it's a job, and I want to keep it as a job, you know? I'd already, before I'd even had success, I'd always joke to my mum, like, Mum, I'm gonna be poor.
Was your mum supportive at a young age?
Oh, she was awesome, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, she was like smart about it, but like,
yeah. She was like, you can do it, but.
Yeah, you can do it, but like finish school.
Finish school.
But Mum was good, better than Dad.
What did he say? Well, how did he handle it?
He was like, nah. It wasn't until he saw me sing that he was like, yeah, okay, that's, yeah, all right, cool. But I think that's the parent's job, right?
I think I was at the gig that maybe your parents first saw you perform at the Meerkat.
It sucked.
Yeah.
Yeah, it totally sucked.
You know what
I
remember?
That was the point. That's why it was private, was to be like, well, that sucked.
What I do remember is, you know, you were quiet. You were working it out and you were quite introverted.
Yeah, I mean, I still...
You didn't look up throughout the whole set.
No, man,
you just sort of played.
Stage fright, yeah.
It was sort of interesting to see how I see you're on stage now. Have you felt like you've come out of your shell or grown as a performer?
Oh, definitely grown. I mean, that's the goal, right, of doing it, because I wouldn't want to just do that every day. But yeah, I used to not be able to even like talk to the crowd or like stand. I remember standing up was like a really big deal for me for a while. And then I would set a goal each tour, and then another one was to like take my hands off the mic stand, and then another one was to like walk away from the mic stand, and I'd set all these goals.
But, so you really incrementally...
Oh yeah, I had to force myself with stuff, yeah. It was like, cause I just sat behind the keyboard like you said, and like, yeah, I mean, for like the first couple of years, you just have anxiety attacks on stage. Just like, it was the worst. I'd like go into a ball and just like not move for 10 minutes, and I hated it so much. But I don't know, I think I was just an introvert, you know? And music was my way of talking to strangers and to people. But then it hadn't occurred to me that I also had to like be on stage and be like, you guys having a great time, you know?
You guys know the words? All right, let's hear it. And talk is cheap, my darling. When you're feeling right at home, I wanna make you move with confidence. I wanna be with you.
Do you remember the first thing you ever recorded?
I remember when I started singing, I was 15.
Right.
And singing in the shower.
You were singing in the shower?
Yeah, that's where, because I didn't know how to sing, and I've always been pretty, like 110% kind of attitude towards something, even if I don't know how to do it. So I would like belt it, you know. I wasn't like singing like, I was like, yeah, you know, like screaming shit. So I'd do it in the shower because I thought no one could hear me. My brother likes to remind me that he could hear me and it sucked, yeah.
Were you self-critical in the way that, like, I don't really sound like...
Oh, sure. I knew I had a weird voice. I mean, yeah, all through school, people always telling me that... My teachers were always telling me to work on my diction because I was mumbling. Basically mumbled my way through life, you know? Usually the things were like, that we're most self-conscious about are the things that a lot of people like about us. You just gotta sing, you know, and like be self-aware. If 10 years later people are like, you still suck, then cool, sing for yourself, you know? But if you get an opportunity to sing for people, then take that opportunity and sing.
Now what do I do? Maybe I'm dangerous, according to you.
You got your guitar, sound check is happening, you're performing tonight at the Emore Theatre.
Uh-huh.
Do you just sit around like strumming and
something? Noodling, sure, yeah. Noodling. This thing folds in half, so I can travel with it. So it's because, you know, every airline in the world will break anything you give them. It's like a mission for them. So this is cool because it folds in half, so the case is small enough that I can take it on the fly.
You've traveled around a fair bit.
Mm.
Recently, you were recording sounds just on the go.
I just had, yeah, this old U87 mic and this like rack mount 70s pre, like wrapped up in socks in the bottom of my bag, and just basically traveled around a bunch. I turned 30 and I was kind of like, first I was kind of bummed out that I didn't have a dog or a girlfriend or anything or a house, and then I was like, well, actually, hold on, what's the flip side of that? I can go wherever I want. So I was like, okay, well, let's embrace that.
Thanks for catching up with me again.
Thanks. You too, man. You mellowed out a bit.
Yeah.
You used to be like, hey, man, how's it going?
I was on a different channel.
Okay, yeah. Right, okay. You got channel moods? Okay, cool.